Yeah, again, welcome. Today, Tuesday, 23rd of June, 2020, we're week 12 or 15. And the courses are AC814 and ACE914, Principles and Practice of Entrepreneurship. Today, we've done the first lecture. We're taking on the second life lecture. We're going to have him, Professor Akim Ajumba, the life from the UK, where the temperature is soaring. I think it's about 36 or 37 degrees Celsius today, June 23rd. Lecture is on running a web-based business in an e-commerce environment. So let's welcome him, our second facilitator. He's no other than Akim Ajumba, an assistant professor of international human resource management and organization and development. He's currently lecturing in the Department of Strategy, Management and Marketing at Birmingham City University in the UK. He has taught and held several top administrative positions across several universities in Nigeria, several universities in Belgium and United Arab Emirates, and of course, the United Kingdom. He has his background in economics and law, and has bagged four master's degrees, four, in various business management fields. And he has a PhD in management at the University of Wales in the United Kingdom. He's also a fellow of seven international organizations, a member of many, too numerous to count. He's a seasoned lecturer and entrepreneur, both in theory and in practice, as he consults for many European and African organizations on management issues. He was director of the Center for Entrepreneurship at the Kwara State University, where I met him, and he became the best director of all such centers in the whole of the Nigerian university system. He's a member of the Institute of Entrepreneurship in Nigeria. Let me welcome him to give us a lecture on running a web-based business in an e-commerce environment. You may have a little bit of challenge with the low bandwidth at his end. This is because it's in an environment, it's in an environment where there's a little bit of challenge. But of course, Professor Ajumbade can give us a lecture even in the harshest place on planet Mars. So over to you, Professor Akim Ajumbade.
Yes, sir. Once again, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. What we want to talk about today is running a web-based business in an e-commerce environment. Almost everywhere in the globe today, I think we can talk about being in an e-commerce environment, almost everywhere. I'm going to start with an apology for the very poor connection of the internet. You experience one, please let me know. I can quickly switch again. But I think the two combined is not even as good as one. So my apologies, please. I'm so sorry. when we talk about running a web-based business, it's as good as us talking about running an online business. That's what fundamentally we are talking about. And the need to run an online business today cannot be overemphasized. As you can see what has happened in the last 3 to 6 months in different parts of the world, as a lot of businesses have had to operate in closed shops. There are quite a lot of them that have had to do that. And even the very big names such as Gucci, Louis Vuitton, mention it, Nike. And the only way they could actually do the delivery of their services is trying to use the logistic offices like the UPS, FedEx to actually deliver. And that is only for those who also make their orders online. So at the end of this session, what we intend to have been able to comprehend, the various steps that are involved in running such a success business, some web-based business ideas some of the common pitfalls that we can try to avoid, benefits and the barriers that are not always very obvious. Well, Internet of Things is what we are talking about. We now say that the world is in our pocket, as most of us now use our our Android phones, we use our iPhone and all of that to do things. But the degree to which we make use of this gadget is what remains questionable. I see quite a lot of things that is used for these things right here in the developed world. Virtually everything you want to do is on your phone. Even if I go to a store now to buy an item, I don't need to carry my card. I can pay with my phone because all I need to do is to scan with the barcode and I pay. If I'm traveling at any point in time, I don't need to print a boarding pass. My phone can do just all of that for me. And that's what people are doing. But when we look at what we are making do with our own mobile phone, everybody wants to have a very sophisticated mobile phone, for example. A lot of people want to have a Macintosh Apple laptop. But are we even making use of one-tenth of the functionality of those things? And if we can explore, we can have a lot of businesses with them. And that's what we are, because it's a technology-driven environment, we cannot but do so much. Gone are those days when you will say, because I'm on a maternity leave, as we now have in Nigeria as well, paternity leave, that is why I cannot work. From the comfort of your home, you can, because there is now flexible working arrangement that has been put in place by various organizations and different institutions. So a lot of people can even have 2-3 jobs like we do in the developed countries. In Nigeria, prior to now, in most parts of Africa, Burundi, Congo, you cannot do more than a job at a time. But today, with the Internet of Things, you can actually have 3-4 jobs and you can cope with all depending on the level of your ability to multitask. And money can be coming in. Please, 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 it is often said, salaries can only pay bills. Sure. Salaries can only pay bills. We need to do business. And one of the ways to be very stable and to survive in business is to have what we call stream of incomes. If you have just one source of income, look at what has happened with the pandemic. Anybody with a source of income is going to really have himself to blame. But when you have stream of income, you can always benefit from what we call business insurance. So if one particular business is not doing well, the other can. And the number of businesses you can have as such that doesn't really require you, depending on what you want. And I'm not talking of those who are investing on things that will give you quick money and I'm not sure of its continuity. I'm not talking of Bitcoin. I'm not talking of things like that. I'm talking of things that have seen the stand the test of time and can actually, see the light of the day. So what are some of the things that we need to do? How do we get started if you want to do an online business? It is slightly different from doing the conventional businesses, but there are quite a lot of similarities. The very first thing you need to do is to conduct a market research. How do you conduct your market research? You do interview. You can do questionnaire. It depends on the nature of business you actually want to do. There are so many of them, that you can do. Recently, somebody contacted me and said they are trying to develop a fragrance and they don't know whether people want and whether people will buy or not. And before you know it, they developed a questionnaire of just 9 questions asking people how often do they use perfume, do you do collection of it, how much do you spend on it, on things like that. If you do that, people, you will be able to get some level of information from people to actually know. Through your market research as well, you will know who your competitors are, the size of the market already. Is there any market gap? Why do I have to go into this? Is there market demand? Does there exist any form of gap? So you must do your competitive analysis. Through your competitive analysis, you are in a competition that takes place at a particular environment. You need to choose your online business model. What sort of online business model do you want to adopt? Is it one that people will be able to, do you want to have an unlock so that people can actually check what you want your product to buy and make up? Is it one in which you are talking to them and then they are just now going to make their order? Or do they pay per click? Anytime they click and go on your website, is it something that they have to pay for? So you must have a business model. Your business model will really help you in doing your business success. The other one is you need to build a website. Again, there are 3 ways you can possibly build a website. Trust me, you can do websites yourself. If you go on YouTube, for example, there are many videos that teaches you on how to do website. But it's time for you to save costs. The other way to build a website is to use the website building tools. Again, they are available online. And there are some of them, there are some people that also build website for you for free.
Sure.
But then it comes with a different kinds of package at another point. So you can also have that. Then the third one, which is the most expensive one, is to give it to a developer to build the website for you. That's the most expensive. There's nothing wrong in doing that if that is what you want to do. But you will have to develop the content that you put on the website. The website will help your visibility because it will help you a lot to be known. And you can sit in the comfort of your home and be known globally. Then the other thing you need to do is to fill your site with optimized copy. And what do we mean by filling your site with optimized copy? You must make yourself very visible. We have what you call SEO. SEO is search engine optimization. By the search engine optimization, how often do you come up when people get on Google search, for example? Where do you come up? Do I have to get to 7-10 page before I can see you? So you must ensure that your search engine optimization is very good, such that whenever people log online, you are visible. Example, your name on Google search. Let's say you just type your name. What comes up? What is it that people will say about you? That confirms that you are on LinkedIn, that you have made some publications. What is it that you want people to see about you? So is that visibility that will also help your product as well? Then comply with online business legal requirements or regulations. We have all seen how very big ones, the giants in the industry, have run into a lot of problems due to data protection. Facebook, just last year, ran into a lot of problems. You will recall, Facebook ran into a lot of problems and it had to be summoned by the United States. Because of data breach, because people's information were divulged without the knowledge of the organization, because they were hacked. So when that happens, it can be a lot of problem. Consumer Protection Act is there. So whenever you are going to operate an online business, you must know the legal regulation, because you're having people's information. You are having people's information. When you have people's information, like their date of birth, their name, their addresses, their phone number, their emails. These are very essential that anybody can make use of. So you must ensure that it can be adequately protected. Otherwise, your business can go down overnight. Again, you must launch social media channels. There are lots of ways we can make ourselves visible. If you look at it in our various countries today, there is virtually no university that I know that is not on Facebook. Why do you think they are? Why are they there? Because they want to be more visible, because they've seen that Facebook has over 1 billion followers on a daily basis. So one of the ways of making themselves visible is that. So you see a lot of people doing businesses on Instagram. Facebook now doing things on TikTok and stuff. So make the most of the social media available. Then you must attract traffic. You must attract a lot of traffic to your website. And how do you attract traffic to your website? That's why when you see most of the viral videos, people will say, please don't forget to subscribe. Please click like. That's what they're trying to do. They're trying to attract more traffic, because the more traffic they have on their site, the better for them. And that is what will determine the amount of money they are also able to make. Now, there is this empathy map that I want to quickly talk about. Empathy map is something that you can use in actually understanding the thinking of your consumers, so that you can try to get into the mind of the consumers. The black picture that shows a human being that you have there is just like getting to the head of an average consumer. You want to try and get to the head of their consumers, of your consumers or potential consumers. What is it that the consumers are thinking about? How do they really feel? When you look at the consumers, what do you see? What do you think the consumers are seeing in their immediate environment? How do you think the consumers see social media? Is it a consumer or a set of consumers that makes use of websites? You must try to understand that, because if you cannot probe into the mind of your consumers, if you cannot see through the eyes of your consumers, then you cannot actually serve them very well. What does your consumer say about this particular product or about that type of product if yours is new? What do they do with it? So you must be able to visualize that. You must do that by putting yourself in the position of the consumer. Now, what would you do? What do you hear the consumer says? And that's what we call the empathy map. Now, the empathy map tries to fuse the pain of the consumers. And that is why you are going into the business. Like Dr. Francis that runs a hospital, for example, he might feel pains of his client. And in trying to feel the pain of your client, that helps you to actually say, okay, then what do they need? What do they need? If I recommend or prescribe this particular one, is this something they will be able to afford? Okay, if I recommend this one. So that is empathizing with them. Ditto, like Mr. Okori said earlier about parents and paying school fees and then mounting debt. These are some of the things. So you try to, whenever you are coming up with a policy, you think for them, you try to feel them, you empathize, you try to hear what they are saying. And because you are the owner of the business, you are unlikely to hear them directly. That's why you need your foot soldiers, your frontline workers. You need to call out to them because they need to come and give you the feedback. So when you're now doing this online as well, ditto, because you need to be able to get constant feedback. How many times do people try to buy on your site and then you see that the cart is empty again? Why is it that they abandon it? Is it that the site is not user-friendly? Is it very complicated? Is it the means of payment that is important? That is what the empathy app does for you. You can also use the empathy map in team building and team working in your various organization. But time will not permit us to go into all of that. But please, because we are scholars, try to research more into empathy map. It can help you a lot in doing quite a lot of things with your organization. Now, there are so many, too numerous to mention, web-based businesses. It depends on what interests individuals. So I've just mentioned very few of them here. We have those that you can set up in form of having an e-commerce store. Like I said, we have a lot of people who are selling shoes and bags, who are selling perfume, who are selling a mobile phone. And all they do, they don't have a physical shop. They do not. But what they do is to actually display this on their various sites. That's when you have an e-commerce store. You don't have a physical location. People are not coming to your store to pick it. They're ordering it there, and all it's done is to get it delivered through logistics system. You can start an online SaaS. That's what you call software as a service. Software as a service. You can run it. You made a fantastic software. I mean, that's where you have the likes of the apples of this world, the likes of Facebook. You can create and also sell handmade items. There are quite a lot of that in Africa, like we have seen today. A lot of people are coming up with different kinds of handmade items, and they are actually selling them online. You can create a killer at one app can make you for the rest of your life. I'm very sure you are aware that I think way back in 2006, YouTube was actually bought by Google. If you know now, you know that YouTube is not just on it. So it has been taken over by Google and that is one of the things that makes Google the biggest name in the world. When you talk about the number one brand name in the world, some 7 years ago, it used to be Coca-Cola. But today, consistently, it has been Google. The way people talk about Google, everything you just hear, go and Google it, forgetting that Google is actually the name of a company, but it's not even a name. It's not even a name on its own. It's not an English word on its own. But that is how much they've registered that brand kind of people, just like what Apple has successfully done again. You can also start a YouTube channel where people you call the YouTubers. Those who are YouTubers are also making a lot of money. It takes time to build the followership, but when you reach certain threshold, your money just continuously flowing, and all you do is to just sustain that. Then you can start a blog. We have many of them around Africa, we have in Nigeria, like Linda Ikeji, we have Choke Maki. We have quite a lot of them who are bloggers, and they are also making money while sitting in the comfort of their various home. You can also do market research. Market research can be done. For example, you can be a consultant and work market research for the organized. So you can do the survey then as a consultant. You're not living in the comfort of your home. You develop the website, you have their client base, and then you roll it out. You do the analysis of this particular survey, and then you give the organization a report. Once your report found to be credible, the organization is going to pay you. And you can imagine, you can do that all through the year for different organizations. And money will just be flowing in for you. You don't have to do it yourself. You can also have a team of people who are working for you, who are your, foot soldiers, who will be doing this. And all of this is not even going to take your time. You can add it to whatever you are currently doing. Again, we have what we call drop shipping. By drop shipping means buying online. The delivery is done by another organization. The one that is being is the drop shipper. So I can start a drop shipping business where all I do is to ensure the delivery, like what we call the logistic business. That's all I'm doing. You are not seeing the product. The organization that you're selling is not seeing it. I'm just the intermediary between the buyer and the seller, and I get it dropped off. That's what you call drop shipping. Then you can also have HR consultancy online. A lot of people can do that. Like Mr. Corey was talking about, you can use the service of HR consultant. You can be an HR consultant, being an educationist yourself, who have been in the industry for a long time. Leveraging on managing schools, you can become a consultant to startup businesses. And all you do is to deliver the training for them online. And then you get paid for it. So there are so many business ideas. In the printing industry, in the photo industry, so many, too numerous to mention. We just have to decide where our passion lies and what we actually think we are capable of doing. Now, there are some common mistakes while we try to do this particular type of online business or web-based business. And what we focus on is not have a good survey. When you have not conducted a survey of your customers, you have not probed into the mind of the consumers enough. You have not used very well your empathy map to understand what the consumers want. If you don't, well, it is no good. Let me give you a very simple example of a physical proof. If you live in a particular estate, for example, and you notice that in your estate there is no cyber cafe at all, and you now say, oh, because there is no cyber cafe on this estate, I'm going to have a cyber cafe. You may be wrong. Yes. The fact that there is no cyber cafe on the estate does not mean people need it. Sure. The bulk of people that lives on your estate may actually be people who don't have internet at all and in their offices. Sure. So they will not even come to cyber cafe in the first instance. So it would be wrong for you to sit in the comfort of your bed and think you actually know what the consumers want. So what we have often advised is do not run after the product that will satisfy the customers, because what you are selling is solution. Those who run after money don't make money. It's those who run after providing solution that actually make money, because solution is what people want. Again, customers' problems and needs to be validated. You need to understand their pains. You need to understand. That's why, again, I'm talking about the empathy map. When you fail to clarify what the satisfaction gap is, for example, you look at it. What do you think people have reservation about when it comes to using an iPhone? That's the first question you ask yourself. When Huawei product came up and become a big challenge to an iPhone, it looks at it. By the time iPhone came out and start with a 3 camera, I already had a Huawei phone for 1 year with 4 cameras. And because Apple was coming with how many megapixels, maybe 24 megapixels. The Huawei phone has been a year before them, 4 megapixels. And because Apple Huawei, a China product, was becoming a lot stronger, but they started the crisis with them. That meant that the financial controller of Huawei must be repatriated to the US. Of course, government of China also intervened. What I'm trying to say is that while we saw the gap in the satisfaction of the consumer, and they tried to fix that immediately, and it instantly become a threat. Again, you must understand what exactly the consumers want. Then failure to have a follow-up email. Anytime people visit your site, anytime they click to go into your site, you must endeavor to follow up. Follow up. It's just like somebody who attend an interview, and after the interview, you feel, well, I don't know, I think they've decided those who they want to take. Good or bad, when you get old, it's always good to send an email. Send an email to the HR. Oh, thank you so much for giving me the audience, for being a part of you. And look forward to being a part of your lovely family. Can't wait to start with you. It doesn't mean that they are going to give you up. They do or not. It's courtesy. So when people visit your site, you need to follow with emails to them. Follow-up email is likely to get you connected to them. You never can tell how many sites the person visits in an hour, but who gets back to them often get a repeat business. Again, not doing a good search engine optimization for your website. Again, that's what I talked about earlier, when you need to have very good visibility. And failure, my social media platform. Your social media platform, you must make sure you are everywhere. From Instagram to TikTok, from TikTok to Twitter, from Twitter to Facebook to WhatsApp. You must be readily available. And I must say that this may be something that is beyond you. You may have to be a service of I put this together using the tried and true strategy. The tried and true strategy is also very good in capturing consumers or your customers. Whether you are looking at the consumers or you are looking at the customers, well, this tried and true strategy is a very good one. You look at the services you have, then the marketing and sales is important. How do you do that? First thing you want to do is to attract. When you attract, then you delight them, make them happy. So they don't want to go on the time of them. You have strangers, they have no doubt, want to attract them. You have some other prospects who are likely, who you could win over. Then you have existing customers who you want to retain, and then those who are actually going to be the ones that promote your business. This is not only good for online business, it's also good for physical as well. So the true is the very good customer check at the top. Now, this is very important. Causing the very important one. Some of us who are students of management, marketing, would have seen this before. You've seen what you call the early adopters, laggard, the late adopters, early majority, and that is what crossing the chasm is all about. That's when it was developed by Geoffrey Moore. Well, now, what we are saying here is that when a product is just developed, when you just develop your website, or when you just an online, they don't know you. So where it be, you are first going to be in the red zone. Red zone. Time a technology comes up, people who are likely to first get it will be very small. Those are the people you refer to as technology enthusiasts. They anything new, anything high tech, they just want to try. They will be very small. People who feel, well, this is not bad. I'm going to give it a go. My MD is using it. My friend is using it. I talked with a pilot at the airport. He's up. The network with the vision, we think that this is the next level. This is where the world is going now. If you ask me today, I think in no time, issues like business management, marketing, careful, if us choose it, they may be thrown out of the window because the world is not talking about artificial intelligence. We are talking about robotics. So people who want to do business really, maybe begin to think of business analytics. Into business analytics. Don't be quick to realize, I don't know, be visionaries. They are already there. So they are not many. But when your life as it is until you cross that, can see the job market. But how you can be small majority? That is the cousin. That is where now move to the green zone. Because these people are saying that could not be affected.
Yeah, sorry.
This particular slide. Now, startup loop of despair. We all know what despair means, hopelessness. So this is one of the online business. And they are just, look at the two diagrams on the same page, and you will notice something. A lot of businesses start with the idea in their head, then they develop the idea, develop a brand, and then go straight to the customers. When they get to the customers, they now realize that, oh, we've got it wrong. This is not how the customer wants it packaged. This is not how they actually want it. Then they go back again to start from the idea. Now move to the bottom one. Now you now see that you develop the idea. Immediately you develop the idea. Before you go into production, go straight to the consumers. Go to the customers. Test the market. Give them the product. Get their feedback. Do your correction. Then build. Then when you build, then you develop the brand. With that, you are already very safe. Do not use the first one, and that is why this is called the loop of despair. And it happens to quite a lot of businesses. Why should you run a web business? Okay, what are some of the advantages? You can start with very little cost, but your return on investment is almost unlimited. That is the thing. You don't need a physical shop. You don't need all of that. You can start alone. You don't hire anybody. You don't increase your bills from what you are paying. All you need is either your smartphone or your laptop, and then you are good to go and be ready to do your data subscription. You can also automate. That's one good thing about online businesses or web-based businesses. You can automate because you can work from anywhere in the world. If any one of us want to get proof anytime, anywhere it is, it's always readily available online. I don't know why. I don't know how Prof does it. You get a mail from him 5 a.m. You get a mail from him 11 midnight. You get, and I am like, if Prof is still working like this, some of us are in trouble. We are in big trouble. Honestly, when I wake up to see your email at 5:30 in the morning, I'm like, I don't know how you do it, sir, but may the Lord continue to strengthen you. Again, it is often, web-based business is often recession-proof. It is often recession-proof. Correct. Because whatever happens, whatever the recession, look at during the pandemic, who are the people smiling? Who are the people that are not even blinking an eye? So that's the good thing. It is always mentally stimulating. Why? Because it's very, very dynamic. It's very fluid. It's a volatile business environment. So you are constantly kept on the edge. You cannot go to bed with one eye closed when you are doing a web-based business. So you are constantly challenged. Things are happening, and you cannot afford to slumber. Faster delivery of products, that is something that is guaranteed. Then you will, because you are relating with the world, you don't know where these customers are coming from. You cannot but learn the act of professionalism. Then what can be more environmentally friendly than a web-based business where you deal less with papers? It's a paperless kind of business. Finally, what are some of the barriers to operating web-based businesses? Of course, you want to find the right idea. That's the first thing. You must find the right idea. What is it that interests you? Please don't follow the mad crowd. Don't do it because others are doing it. You must be sure this is something that interests you. Lack of trust is another thing that affects it. Lack of trust on both parts. Once some customers till today will tell you, I don't even have an ATM, or I don't have any online bank. I don't believe in it, because they believe that their account can be hacked. Some customers don't want to pay because they are not sure if they will be the product will be delivered. And some have the problem of trust of, am I sure that what I ordered is what will be delivered? So the trust is a very big issue when you are doing a web-based business. Attracting the perfect customer is also something. You must have your own niche. You must have your own target customer base. And when you get them, please try not to lose them. Slow adoption of mobile payment system. That is still something that is a big challenge in Africa. It is not much of a challenge in the developed countries, but in Africa, it's still a huge challenge. How many businesses use POS today? And how many times have we even tried to pay with those that use POS, and then you see that there is no network, or the machine is not working? So we have had a lot of that. So that's also a problem. How do you generate traffic to your site is another problem. So you need to be able to, that's when I talk about the search engine optimization, the poor shopping experience and lack of favorable reviews. If people also do business with you, if they shop with you, and at the end of the day, their experience was not very good, that can really affect your business and it can spell doom. Again, if the review, most of the time when people want to buy online, they go to check the review people have given about you. If the review are not favorable, then it can also affect you, which is why you must do a follow-up. Almost every customer. Converting your shoppers into paying customers. A lot of people will visit your site in a day, maybe 10,000. You may be lucky to get only 10 buying. How do you get 10% of those who visit your site daily? How do you convert them into your customers rather than just shoppers? That's also another important thing. Then how do you retain the customers when you have them? These are some of the barriers that as business people who are operating online or web-based business, we need to bear in mind. Finally, listen to what these people, what they had to say. The founder of Google, Sergey said, when Sergey and I founded Google, we hoped, but did not expect it will reach the current size and influence. Our intense and enduring interest was to objectively help people find the information efficiently. That was when Google was founded in 1996. Today, Google is a $1 trillion worth of business. So, but when they started, the business has grown beyond what they think. Look at what Jeff Bezos, the richest man in the world today is Jeff. That's the owner of Amazon. He's the richest man in the world today, despite the fact that the wife took about 40% of his money after their divorce. The man is still the richest man. And his idea is very simple. It's based on three tenets. So you must bear this in mind, because these are very successful ones in the web-based business. He said, we had three big ideas at Amazon that we have stuck with for 18 years. This was said in 2017. That was in 2017, he said. And they are the reason we are successful. The first one is the customer first. The second one is to continue to invent. And the third one is to be patient. Please, if we can learn some things from some of these, we can actually go far. And listen to what Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook said. He said, I am here to build something for a long time. Anything else is a distraction. We are going to see a lot of distraction in the course of trying to develop our own business, but we must keep our focus. We are keeping our focus means we must continue to eat until the door is open. And finally, Chad Olley, who was one of the three people that started YouTube, said, as you start building the product, please don't assume that you know all the answers. You must listen to the community. Who are the community? The customers. And adapt. It's only when you do that, that you can stand the test of time in the business. Once again, I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to interact with you, and I appreciate you. And I apologize for the disruption and the epileptic supply of my internet facilities. Thank you so much.
Oh, wonderful. Fantastic as always, Professor Akeem Ajumbade. You are just in a class of your own.
Thank you, sir. You
take on entrepreneurship with passion. And it has shown, you see, if you look at your trail, in Nigeria, in UAE, and everywhere, I'm telling you, I can see a note from Madam Deborah Oluwase Idairo to everyone. That is awesome. Very wonderful. And I'm sure she's speaking the mind of us all. So you may wish to unshare your screen so that we can see ourselves and interact with you. If you want to ask a question or make an observation, we'll be glad to have them now. Your screen is still being shared. Yeah, okay, that's fine. So if you want to take the floor, please let us know. We have all enjoyed this presentation, and apparently I can see that they have all going to be implementing all that you have said. They have made notes. The video will come in a minute. Ibe Mercy, Mrs. Mercy Ibe is telling you, Professor Akeem, for a wonderful presentation. Okoro is saying, well packaged and inspiring. Of course, very, very inspiring. Oh, our VC is here, Professor Abayomi Arigbabu. Yeah, he should receive an award. He's going to get an award from us, but he should receive a national award for the university that has been most promising in the area of institutional entrepreneurship. So if we don't have any comments or observation for Professor Akeem Ajumbadi, I'm telling you that he is somebody that's very dear to my heart in terms of being a scholar, in terms of being an entrepreneur, and being a people's person. He practices what he preaches. He doesn't come here to give you all the theory and expect that you will implement it. But he does what he says we should do. So on that note, I would like to invite Henry Okore to please, on our behalf, make a presentation of our plaque to Professor Akeem Ajumbadi. So you have the floor.
Thank you, sir. Appreciation, Lagos State University, Africa Center of Excellence for Innovative and Transformative STEM Education, a World Bank project. This is to certify that Professor Akeem Ajumbadi facilitated courses AC814 and AC914, June 22nd to 27th, 2020. Signed, Distinguished Professor Peter Okebukola, OFR Director. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. All of these certificates, although they are virtual, you know, you're teaching us e-commerce now. Although this certificate for Ajumbadi is virtual, but we are going to get a framed version from us, a beautiful framed version. We can see at your back that you have some nice pictures of family and friends, I think. So these two certificates that you are getting from us will decorate. Your room,
thank you,
and your office, for your office,
thank
for them
you,
to
sir.
Know that you are not just a Nigerian person and thank a UK-based person, but you're a global person. So we deeply appreciate you, and we leave you in the hand of God, that God should cover you with His wings and continue to protect Amen. And be with you and keep let Amen. You be a shining star always.
Thank you.
So once again, I'm going to invite us all to give a round of applause to Professor Akeem Ajumbadi. I'd especially thank our father, Professor Juma Shabani. Professor Shabani, you know, you are just too much. You are just too much. You are leading a band of doctoral students. By the time, Juma, don't worry. By the time they become DG UNESCO, you will be maybe like you are just 40 years old now. You'll be like 45 years old, and so they're going to celebrate you. What I'm saying in essence is that all the students that you are investing in, that we all collectively are investing in will be pride for us and a pride for Africa, pride in the world. I'm not leaving out Professor Dr. Yemisi Akinrade, who has been so wonderful. They have all learned. Actually, the consanity bit has let me mute him. And we would like to thank all of you. Tomorrow is a day of presentation, so we are looking forward to the graduate seminar that will happen tomorrow. Ibe Mercy, you are presenting tomorrow. Yeah, I can see you are. So, and all of you that are presenting tomorrow, I wish you all the very best. So enjoy the rest of the day and Take care.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.